It is with great honor that I'm able to introduce Mr. Frank DeAngelis this morning. I met Frank several months ago by email and telephone, and then he was able to join us for a session that we did in June with some safe schools teams from schools around the state. Our agency has coordinated for several years the Safe and Supportive Schools training, so I'm often researching safe schools initiatives. I came across an organization called Safe and Sound, which was organized by a group of parents that lost students at Sandy Hook School. And I was able to talk to their leading founder, Michelle Gay. And she was very gracious. She wanted to really work with West Virginia, and she wanted to come here. But she wasn't available for our session, so she said, would you mind if I have the recently retired principal from Columbine High School contact you, and maybe he could come? So I kind of, in my mind, tried to keep it low key and say, oh my gosh, that would be so much better than you. So so he was with us in June, and our entire audience just thought he did a great job. So we're so excited to have him back today. Mr. DeAngelis started at Columbine High School in 1979. He started as a social studies teacher and a baseball coach. He became the principal in 1996, and he spent 18 years leading Columbine High School, 15 of them since the tragedy that happened there in April of 1999. What he shares with you is not a story of tragedy, or really even of school safety. It's a story of survival, of compassion, of rebuilding school culture, and a story of leading in change. And I think that's what you'll take away from his presentation most, and you'll be able to relate to him being a leader of the school and of the community. And we're so thankful that he is willing to share that so openly. We're privileged to have him with us today, so please, let's get right into it and welcome Mr. Frank DeAngelis.
Thanks, Lori. Cassie Bernal, Stephen Kernow, Corey DePooter, Kelly Fleming, Matt Kechter, Daniel Mauser, Danny Rohrbaugh, David Sanders, Rachel Scott, Isaiah Scholes, John Tomlin, Lauren Townsend, and Kyle Velasquez. It was 16 years ago in which 12 students and a dear friend of mine was killed by two of my students, and I made a promise on that day that there was nothing I could possibly do to bring them back, and it was something that I was going to have to live with for the rest of my life. But I made a promise, if there was anything I can do until the day I die, is to go out and make sure that we could prevent any other students from dying or teachers from dying. And in my retirement, I was hoping to be more proactive than reactive. During my career, I was called to Sandy Hook, and I was called to Virginia Tech in Chardon, Ohio. But what I'm doing now in retirement is going out to help people realize what can we do to possibly prevent these shootings. And many times people will say, well, Frank, the shootings continue, but the thing that we do not want to underestimate is all the ones that have been stopped as a result of lessons learned at Columbine High School. And I am so glad to be here. What a wonderful state. And it was difficult. I just want to share, you know, I've learned over the years to be able to overcome adversity, but yesterday I left Denver at about 12:15, and the plane was late, and it was not going to be a problem for a connecting flight, other than the fact that I had about a half hour to get from Charlotte to the plane to get here, and there was a dent in the door, and all of a sudden they were not letting us off the plane. So I had 5 minutes, and I'm running through the airport with my backpack, and I found out what humidity really is. And all of a sudden, I'm getting there, and they're shutting the door on the plane. And the lady said, well, it's only a three-hour drive up to Charleston. She said, it's a pretty nice drive, and it's straight forward. And so a guy saw that I was in dismay, and he said, well, let's see if I can get you on the plane. So I got on the plane. It was great. So Mindy picks me up. I'm at the baggage claim, and they said, we can't find your bag. And so I get there, and I had jeans on in a shirt, and Mindy said, well, just present tomorrow. They'll understand. I said, you don't understand. I was raised by nuns in a parochial school, and we never wore jeans. I mean, we wore blue pants and a powder blue tie or shirt and a tie. So I'm at Macy's last night at 8:45, buying a suit and a shirt, saying, if I need to, I'm going to have this outfit. So luckily, someone knocks on my door at 1:30 this morning and says, here's your suitcase. So this is my own suit, and I'm going to, have to either take that suit back or hopefully my wife will let me keep it, so I'm just glad to be here. Colorado native, the Mile High City, and that's really taken on a whole new meaning with the legalization of marijuana being the Mile High City. And I tell people, if you come to Colorado and someone offers you some edibles, beware or sit back and enjoy. You're going to have a great time. But I'm full-blooded Italian, and that's why they said, do you want a roving mic? And I said, yes. Speak a lot with my hands. And I got to share a story about the Italians. It was real interesting. I was getting ready to present, and I think it was in Baltimore, and some guy comes up, and he saw my last name, and he said, you're full-blooded Italian. I said, well, yeah, how'd you know that? And he said, man, you look like you just walked out of the movie The Godfather. And I said, okay. And he said, I love Italy. I love the language. I love the music. I love the food. He said, tell me about your family. I said, well, three of my grandparents were from Sicily. Another one was from the northern part of Italy. And he said, well, speak the language. And I said, my dad's from New Jersey. My mom's from Colorado. And I don't speak Italian. He said, I am not going to let you go until you say something in Italian. I said, I cannot speak the language. He said, I'm going to bug you until you say something in Italian. I said, you promise you'll leave me alone? He said, yes. I said, shut up and get in the trunk. And that's the last time he said anything to me, and so everything was fine. 35 years at Columbine, and I was so, so blessed to be a part of a wonderful high school. And there's not a day that goes by that I don't miss being there. I wore many hats, as Laurie pointed out. I was a social studies teacher for 15 years. I was assistant football coach, believe it or not, an assistant basketball coach. And I ended up coaching. When I grew up in North Denver, we were all Italians. I was one of the bigger kids. They used to call me Stretch. That goes to show you how tall those little Italian kids were. But when I went to Columbine, I decided to teach, and I really loved teaching. And it was very difficult, as I'll tell you later, to get into administration. I'm sure many of you went through the same problem, whether or not to leave the classroom to become an administrator. Had an uncle who told me, choose a job you love and you never have to work a day in your life. And I can assure you, and you're going to hear me today talk about passion, loving what you do. And I made a promise to myself, if I ever had woke up in the morning counting the days until I was going to retire, counting the days until summer vacation, I was getting out. And I had staff members that came to me and said, Frank, I only have 15 more faculty meetings, or I only have 10 more Mondays. And I said, it's so sad that it got to this point in your career that you don't want to be here. And even with everything I went through at Columbine on that horrific day, there wasn't a day that I did not want to walk into that school. And you know this as principals, as administrators. When you walk into a classroom, you can tell which teacher is passionate about teaching and who wants to be there. Those are the teachers that never have any attendance problems because kids want to be there. Those are the teachers that do not have any problems with tardiness because kids want to be there. It's about passion and loving what you can do. And kids are smart. They can pick up on it. So I was so blessed to choose this job of education, and I would do it all over again, even with everything I had been through. I'm going to tell you about Columbine High School. And the thing that's amazing is after I do some presenting, people will come up and say, gosh, your school, your community is just like ours. Columbine High School is located just outside of Denver, Colorado, in a little town called Littleton, unincorporated Jefferson County. 85,000 students in Jefferson County, 152 schools in Jefferson County. There were 23 high schools. We have we had a graduation rate of 93%. Over 88% of our kids go on to college, with 25% getting scholarships, a lot of parental support, a lot of community support. It was a great suburban high school. It was students that cared about learning, parents who cared about learning, community that valued education. We have extensive advanced placement classes. We have international baccalaureate program, but we also have the highest rate of students that are on individual learning plan or educational plans. Our school had an opportunity to march in the Rose Day Parade back in 2002. Great high school. I was at Columbine for 20 years, and then April 20th, 1999 occurs. And all of a sudden, it's a beautiful spring day, and it was about 70 degrees, and I did not start out at Columbine on that particular day. I was at a business breakfast for some students that were receiving some awards, so I returned to Columbine. It was around 11:15, and I was getting ready to go to cafeteria duty, and I was one of the few principals that loved cafeteria duty. People look at me saying, "You've got to be kidding me." But I enjoy it because I get an opportunity to see the students in a different light. And so I'm late. I'm talking to a teacher offering a continuing contract because he was on a one-year contract. And my secretary comes up to me, and she said, "Frank, there's been a report of gunfire down in the cafeteria." Immediately, my mind shifts. How could this be happening at Columbine High School? If you would have asked me, could a Columbine happen at Columbine prior to it happening? It doesn't happen in our community. And a piece of advice that I'm going to share with each and every one of you, it can happen anywhere. We're all vulnerable. I can remember when I went to Sandy Hook after their tragic event, they were in disbelief, just as I was. I ran out of my office, and immediately I'm thinking, it's got to be a senior prank. This can't be happening. Then my worst nightmare became a reality. I ran out of my office, and coming towards me is a gunman. And I vividly remember the gunman with his hat on backwards. He had a black vest on, t-shirt, jeans, and boots. And all I remember hearing was shots being fired. And I later found out what I went through was fight, flight, and freeze. Fight, flight, and freeze. And I kept thinking so vividly what it was going to be like to be shot. I had never been put in a situation like that. When I went to college, you're never trained to deal with situations. And I kept thinking about my family. I kept thinking what it was going to feel like to have a bullet pierce my body. And luckily for me, some girls were coming out of the hallway. They were coming out of the dressing room to go to a physical education class and allowed me to redirect myself. And all I remember is our minds do different things when you're under stress. I don't remember the fire alarm going off. We would not even be able to carry on a conversation. It was so loud, but I blocked that out. But I do remember the strobe lights. I remember the shots being fired. I remember glass breaking behind me. And I froze, and everything seemed to slow down. And the girls came in, and they were going to be right in the harm's way. And fortunately, they allowed me to redirect my attention. What I needed to do was to protect them. A lot of things happened that day that I can't explain, but for whatever reason, it wasn't my time to die. I had a set of keys, 35 keys, and I reached into my pocket, and I had a suit coat on, or a suit pocket. I reached in my key, or in my pocket. The gunman's coming towards us. We were trapped in this little area, and I pulled out the one key, the master key that opened every door in there. And the thing that's so eerie, and I still get chills thinking about it, because I tried that time and time again for the next 15 years, and I was never able to do it. So someone allowed me to get the composure, to reach in my pocket, put it in the door slot, and get it to safety. Now, one of the things, and I'm going to talk about survivor's guilt, because one of the things that's devastating to me is I found out later that the gunman did not rush after me and the girls because he stopped and went after Dave Sanders, who came up the hallway, and Dave got shot through the back of the head, and he later died. So all of a sudden, I found out that I'm standing here before you, or I survived that day because Dave Sanders came up the hallway. It was a war zone. And one of the things that I hear every time I go out is people thank me. Because many of the things that you're doing, many of the things you're going to learn today by the other excellent presenters, are you're doing things differently than what we did at Columbine. On that particular day, we had in place a plan called secure the perimeter. And it was tough for law enforcement agents. They allowed the gunmen, the two killers, 40 minutes in the building. And they killed kids. And we are lucky the bombs did not explode. They wanted to kill kids. There would have been 500 or 600 kids killed if the bombs would have exploded. And they learned how to build those bombs on the internet. And they were wired to perfection, but they were supposed to use metal on metal, and they ended up using plastic on plastic. And their plan was not to shoot the kids inside the building. Their plan was to stand outside and shoot kids as they ran out of the building. And they even had their two cars booby-trapped that they were set to go off about 10 minutes after the original bombs went off, and they were placed strategically in the parking lot because they knew where the first responders were going to show up. They were going to kill as many kids as possible. And on that day, our SRO, Neil Gardner, was such a hero, and he actually engaged with the shooters outside, but they were standing on top firing down, and they had more weaponry than Neil Gardner. And I still remember once I got outside the building and I was able to get the girls to safety and I was going to go back in, and they said, "We're not sending anyone in. The building is not safe." And I can remember police officers saying, "The reason we're wearing this badge is to protect kids, and kids are dying in that building." And it was difficult because there were about 300 kids that were trapped in the building, and they're looking down and looking at police officers and first responders, and they were being told not to go into the building until they made sure the building was safe. Well, since that time, things have changed, and you're going to hear about active shooters and things of that nature. But on that day, I can remember helping the police, and they brought out a grease board. And put your principal's hat on for a second. You're in shock. And how many of you would be able to draw the schematics of your building knowing where the air vents are? I could not even remember what the numbers were on the classroom doors, but the SWAT team was planning their attack based upon my drawings of the building, and they said, "Where do the air ducts run through the science wing? And do you know near what classroom?" And they were planning their attack upon me. At one point, they were going to put a bulletproof vest on me to send me into the building to shut off the fire alarm, because the police officers could not communicate. Things have changed. Now we have everything in a mobilization center in which every school floor plan is computerized. We can shut off things remotely. And so there were a lot of lessons learned. I saw things that day that I never learned in principal school. It was a war zone. I can remember being called to go on the back of a paramedic's truck to identify one of our students. And they said, "Can you identify?" And it was Lance Kirkland. And I can still remember he had been shot in the face. And I'm in shock, and all of a sudden I see half of his face missing. And the police officer said, "Frank, who is it?" And I said, "It's Lance Kirkland." And I said, "Is he going to be all right?" And they said, "He's probably not going to make it." Miraculously, he did. And that's the story of Columbine, kids who made it. You know, one of the most difficult things, and it is a marathon and not a sprint, but one of the things that has a lasting memory onto me, and think of this as being a principal or as a parent, one of the things that happened is we had a reunification center, and one of the things I'm going to recommend to you as you get ready to plan a new school year and your emergency plans and you have reunification in case if you have to evacuate the building to go to an off-site place, be careful what you choose. We chose an elementary school. And even though the students at Columbine were deeply impacted, there are elementary school kids that were deeply impacted. Because now, all of a sudden, kids were being escorted out of Columbine High School and they were being reunited with their parents at this elementary school. So now you have first graders through sixth graders that are seeing these parents crying, seeing these kids crying, seeing these kids walk into the building with bloodstained shirts. And these kids were deeply impacted. As the day went on, it was about 8 o'clock at night, and we're in a large gymnasium in an elementary school, and this is something that will never go away in my mind. Time comes, there's no more buses, no more kids are walking across the stage to meet with their parents, and there's still people in there and parents in there. And I remember a grief counselor coming over to me and saying, "Frank, will you go with us to tell the parents that there's a good chance their child died that day in your school?" And all of a sudden, I'm no longer wearing that parent or principal's hat, but I'm wearing that parent hat because I had a teenage daughter who went to a neighboring school. And I can remember going up to those parents, and I can still envision them looking at me, holding me, saying, "How did this happen? I'll never hold my daughter or son again." And I kept thinking their lives had been denied. These fathers would never walk their daughter down the aisle. The mothers would never hold their grandchild, and it happened on my watch. And they cried, and what do you say? I could never say to them, "I know how you feel." Schools are supposed to be safe. They sent their child to my school, and those kids never returned. Michelle Gay shared a story. Her daughter, Josephina, was killed at Sandy Hook. And this touched me so deeply. She said, "Frank," and she knows I'm going to share the story, but she said, "I'll never forget that night at Sandy Hook. I go home, and I have three children. And I go into my daughter's bedroom, and I hold them and clutch them, and I never wanted to let them go because they survived. Then I walked into their sister's room, Josephina, and I hugged her blanket and her teddy bear because that's all I had left." And the impact that that had on people, and the impact it had on Columbine. It's a marathon and not a sprint. Every time we took a step forward, it seemed like we would have to take a step back. It was 6 months after the tragedy. Anne-Marie Hallcoulter was one of the young ladies who was critically injured. She's paralyzed from the waist down. All of a sudden, a detective shows up. And whenever a detective showed up at Columbine, it wasn't usually to say, "Frank, you're doing a great job." Said, "We have some news." And I said, "Now what?" He said, "Anne-Marie Hallcoulter's mom committed suicide. And we need for you to go tell her because the dad wanted you up there." Anne-Marie had a brother, Nathan, there, and I went and got Nathan out of class, and all of a sudden we're sitting in the back of a patrol car. He said, "Mr. D, what is going on?" And the police said, "You can't say anything until we meet with the family." So we drive into the house, the dad's crying, Anne-Marie saying, "What is going on?" Nathan is going on, and the detective said, "Take him into the bedroom," and I had to tell them that their mother had just taken their life. That had an impact on our community. Valentine's Day, 2000, two students, Stephanie Hart and Nick Kuzman, were brutally murdered at a Subway sandwich shop. Killers never found. And then it was May 6th of 2000, a student, Greg Barnes, was a 4-0 student, a good athlete, fantastic kid, had went to prom 2 weeks prior with his friends laughing and joking. On May 6th, he took his own life, and he left stating, "I was in the classroom where we tried to save Dave Sanders' life. He took the wallet of Dave Sanders and was showing pictures to keep Mr. Sanders alive. Mr. Sanders lost his life," and he said, "I can no longer live with those memories," and he took his own life. So every time we seemed to be taking giant steps forward, something would happen. And I was so fortunate to have the support of so many. Of course, my family, my friends, and later you're going to see a little video that includes Mr. Dittman. Mr. Dittman was a person who is the reason I got into education, and I'm so sure all of us chose our profession because of role models we had. Mr. Dittman was mine. In the aftermath, I was so fortunate to have the support of the school board members and superintendents that I was able to fulfill my promise to stay at Columbine High School. In most situations where the principals or assistant principals stay or survive or teachers survive, a lot of times they're moved. And I can remember the day after, before I met with the students and staff, I went in and I went up to the president of our school board and the superintendent, and I apologized, and I said, "If you want me to resign, I will resign." And both of them said, "You can stay principal at Columbine High School as long as you would like. And if you want to be placed somewhere else, we will give into that request. But it is your school. You built this school, and you will continue to rebuild it. And I needed that support. And I need to tell you, it was difficult. And I can remember talking to Bill Bonds from Paducah, Kentucky, where a shooting had occurred at Heath High School. And he said, I can guarantee you within 3 or 4 years, 75% of your staff will be gone. And I said, not at Columbine, because once you get to Columbine, you stay at Columbine. It was a great school. After the class of 2002 graduated, 75% of the staff had left. And when I left last year, or a year ago in 2014, out of 150 staff members, which include classified, certified, or licensure staff, there were 15 of us left. It took its toll. And the reason is, if you survive a traumatic event in your life, you can decide if you want to go back to where that event occurred. If there were survivors of 9/11, you could go back to that ground zero. Or if you just survived a plane crash, and I'm going to talk a little bit later about Gerda Wise-McLean, who was a Holocaust survivor. She decided one day, in order for her to continue to heal, she had to go back to the concentration camp where she witnessed her parents and brother dying. But that was part of the healing process. Anyone who walked back into Columbine High School, whether it be student, a teacher, or parent, had to relive what they had witnessed on that horrific day. And so they were all heroes. I'm going to talk about a couple of things that allowed me to continue to stay at Columbine that allows me to get in front of you today and share my message. And I have known people who have been involved that feel they do not want to talk about it because every time they talk about it, they have to relive those memories. Well, for me, I did not ask to be placed at Columbine High School under those circumstances, but I was. And I can remember it was 2 days after the tragedy. I'm a cradle Catholic. And Father Ken Leone, a dear friend of mine, called me down to the church, St. Francis Cabrini, and he said, Frank, you need to come down here. And I said, Father, I have so many things to take care of. He said, you need to come down here. And I walk in to the church, and there's about 1,200 people. Included in that audience was about 500 students that were members of the parish. And he had all the kids come to the altar, and I was there, and he had them reach out their hand. And he said, you will make this. And he said, Frank, you were spared for a reason. He said, now you need to go and rebuild that community. And talk about feeling the pressure of the world. But he said to me, he said, Frank, you're not going to have to travel that journey alone. And he gave me this quote, Proverbs. And he also said, he gave me a little card, and I don't know if you ever saw it, about footprints, that during our lives, many times, the judgment day comes and gentleman's having a conversation and says, Jesus, how come during my life there was always 4 footprints in the sand during the good times, but during the bad times I had to walk that journey alone and there were only a set of feet? He said, you did not walk it alone. I picked you up and carried you. And Father Kent said, it's going to be tough, but you will not have to travel it alone. And it was my faith that allowed me. And I'm not here to preach, but what I'm telling you, if you go through a traumatic experience, you need to find out what support system you have in place. For me, it was my faith. The other thing that happened is I looked upon others to help me or inspire me. And a few of the people that did that were the young men and women that were at Craig Hospital, a hospital that is renowned for dealing with spinal cord injuries and dealing with brain trauma. Patrick Ireland, Richard Castaldo, Anne-Marie Hallcoulter, and Sean Graves were there. And we have a tendency to kind of feel sorry for ourselves, and you look at other people saying, gosh, they got it made. Why me? Why me? Why me? And one of the things that helped me get to the point that I could continue at Columbine High School is every Saturday I would go to Craig Hospital and spend time with my kids. And I walked in there, and I saw Patrick Ireland, the boy in the window, who had a bullet pierce his brain and was in and out of consciousness, lower himself down, to later become the valedictorian of the school, later to earn a degree, and he's one of my dearest friends. And I walked away from that Craig Hospital saying, how could you feel sorry for yourself when these kids had to learn how to walk again? If they could walk, talk again, they could not even string out a sentence. And the thing that kept me coming back, and this is what represents Columbine High School. I told you about that day. The remainder of my talk is going to be what Columbine represents. What I want you to do now is remember those 13. It was a time to remember, but now I'm going to talk about a time of hope and resolution and resiliency. That's what Columbine represents. And this is, it starts with Sean Graves, a young man. He was a freshman at the time, and his mom said, Frank, can you go talk to him? He is struggling. There's a good chance he's never going to walk again. He's given up hope. And I can remember going to his bedside Saturday after Saturday and saying, Sean, do not give up hope. You have so many people that care about you. You survived. And I said, do not deny me an opportunity to hand your diploma in 2002. And I can remember going Saturday after Saturday to try to encourage him. He left the hospital. He returned to Columbine. He was confined to a wheelchair, but they saw some hope that he may walk. We fast forward to 2002, and he was still spending a majority of time in the wheelchair, but it was graduation day 2002. And all of a sudden, he's in a wheelchair off the stage, and they call his name, and I'm getting ready to hand a diploma, thinking he's going to roll across the stage in his wheelchair. He got up out of the wheelchair, came up, he gave me a hug, and he said, I'm here to get my diploma. That's what Columbine's all about in resolution. And we were able to continue. And it's that we never gave up. How do you keep the momentum going? In our families, if you ever lost a loved one, you've noticed people are coming in, families coming in, neighbors are coming in, the food is coming in. Well, it's the same thing at Columbine. We had so many people that wanted to help us, that would send blankets, and we received more chicken soup books. We received birds. And everybody would call, did you receive it? And all I know is we had a warehouse full of stuff. But that was their way of helping, because everyone was a part of Columbine on that particular day. And the thing, how do you keep it going? And all of a sudden, what I tell people, it's just like in a family. All of a sudden, people return home, the neighbors stop bringing food, but the sorrow was still there. And you need to make sure that you call people to say, how are you doing at anniversaries? How are you doing on birthdays and things? And that's the important thing. And I don't know if there's any politicians in here, but what we've learned, and there's great politicians. I love politicians. But what we learned is we had a lot of political support as long as the cameras were here. But once the cameras were gone, so were the politicians. The true politicians were the ones that were meeting with me in the back of our school on a Thursday night at 9 o'clock when there were no cameras. And Norma Anderson was saying, Frank, what can we do to make schools safer? What can we do to help Columbine? How do you keep the momentum going? I talk about my faith, and the next thing that saved me was counseling. I can remember someone telling me, said, Frank, if you seek medical help, you can no longer be principal of this high school because that's a sign of weakness. And fortunately, I was smart enough not to listen. My mom worked for a chiropractor who was a Vietnam veteran, and he said, Frank, if you don't help yourself, you can't help anyone else. And that was the best piece of advice. I got in for counseling. I wasn't sure why things were happening. My life had changed. I can remember going to a Colorado Rockies game. We have a professional baseball team. I think it's professional. I'm not sure how well they play. But I can remember being at a 4th of July game, and all of a sudden, it's the night that they were going to shoot fireworks. And I'm down on the field with my parents and my brother and sister and my kids, and all of a sudden, the fireworks start going off. And I get in a fetal position. I break out in a cold sweat. I'm nauseous, and I start crying and shaking. And that's when I realized things have changed, that I was being re-traumatized by the flashing lights and the sounds of the exploding fireworks. It was a month after the tragedy, and I went into Columbine 2 days after, or 4 days after the shooting. The FBI agent brought me in, and I can remember walking into our cafeteria set up like this, and I could remember seeing standing water, and it reminded me of the film of the Titanic. And I saw the food that was left on the tables, and all I envisioned, and there were spots of blood throughout, and all I envisioned were those kids, what they went through. And I can remember walking down the hallway where Dave Sanders was shot and seeing knuckle prints in that carpet. And my mind, and I was not feeling a whole lot at that time, but when I realized things had changed, as they took me into the library, and I was with an FBI agent, and I spent 2 hours in there, and he took me around to where every kid had lost his life. And there was the outline of the bodies, there was blood-stained carpet. He had taken me over to where the two killers had taken their own lives. And we were talking like I had done that for my entire life, and I had no feeling or emotion, and that's when I knew things had changed. And that's when I increased the counseling that I got. And luckily, now, when things happen, I know something's not wrong. I have the skills that allow me to cope. And so for any of you, I don't care what the what you go through, you don't have to go through it alone. And it's because of my faith and because of counseling I'm standing before you this morning. I'm Italian. I'm emotional. I get emotional at the grand opening of a Walmart. And when people are telling me, Frank, if you cry in front of kids, you cannot be a leader. You got to be strong, and you can't show any emotion because good leaders are not emotional. And I can remember telling the person, I said, if I am not who I am, if I do not display who I am and wear my emotions on my sleeve, I let down my parents, and I'm going to lead that way because I have led that way for 20 years. It's something that happened. It's not what I said, it's but what I did. We used to meet with the kids prior to going back to school because we could not go to Columbine. We had to go to Chatfield High School, which was about 6 miles away. And we did not go back to school for 2 weeks because we had 13 memorial services we had to attend. And the last thing I wanted to do is have kids go to memorial service and then go to class. So we were fortunate the superintendent said, no, we will not start classes up until the last memorial service. So we go back to school in 2 weeks. Well, meanwhile, we were meeting with kids because the kids wanted to come together. They needed each other, and I would address them each day. Well, one day, I decided the kids needed to be with themselves, and they did not need to hear from me. All of a sudden, a counselor runs in, and they said, Frank, your kids need you. And I said, okay. I walk into an area, and all of a sudden, the kids are chanting, Mr. D, we are Columbine. We are Columbine. We love you. And I get up on stage, and I didn't say a word. But for the first time, I got pretty emotional. And all of a sudden, I look out, and I see the boys crying and the girls crying. And the counselor said, you did not say a word, but your action was the loudest message that you could have possibly have given because I granted permission for those boys to show emotion. And these are things that I never learned. And these were things I was never prepared for. You just respond. And you'd be amazed how you respond because we're all in education. We have law enforcement people that are doing it because we are servants and we're serving kids and we're serving the public and you will do it. If you would have asked me what I have done, what I did that day, I couldn't say yes. But when it happened, I did what I had to do. I had to go to my kids and you would do the same thing. And if it happened again, I would do the same thing. I don't care what program a security director said, well, you need to be the incident commander. I said, I can't be the incident commander because I'm going to go to where the kids are in trouble because they're my kids. But we had a plan in place that we would have an incident commander. It was not going to be me. One of the things that happened, again, that I did not learn in principal school is what do you do when parents create an archway of balloons to welcome kids back and balloons start popping? And you see all these kids diving on the ground because they're re-traumatized. We could not serve Chinese food for a year after the tragedy or longer because that was a meal that was being served the day of the tragedy. If there was ketchup on the table, we had to be careful because it reminded kids of blood. If we did a fire drill, there would be 400 kids that would not be there without their counselor or without their mental health worker. There were songs, and teachers had to change what they were doing because they could not show a video clip of a World War II scene because it would re-traumatize the kid. We had to change curriculum. Then you had the teachers. As teachers, as educators, we're supposed to be tough, but yet they had to walk in those classrooms and they were being re-traumatized. And one of the things that really helped us is we had a pool of substitute teachers. There would be days teachers would walk in and all of a sudden something would happen and we would need to get support for them in that classroom. And the thing that I found out, and this was a great lesson to learn, people deal with stress in different ways. And I used to state, if I made 70% of the people happy on any particular day, I would go home and celebrate. We had a teacher, first day back with the kids, he was stuck in a classroom with 30 kids, not sure if they were going to live or die. The first thing he does when the kids walk in, where's your algebra homework? But that was his way of coping because he felt in his mind, the sooner we get back to doing what we were doing, it's on the road to recovery. We had other teachers that they were told, you have the kids journal. Have the kids journal, express their feeling. I had parents calling saying, Frank, if my kid writes another journal entry, I'm going to throw the journal at you. And we were in different places, and that was the most difficult thing. How do you meet the greater needs? And my mantra was, people are in different places, and we have to respect that. But what we need to do now is stay together. We are Columbine. That's a little bit of post-traumatic, see? And I didn't, okay, we're fine. So, then you have the parents. And the parents, it was real interesting. They would call and say, Frank, we're losing our kids. They will not talk to us. And I said, they don't understand. The kids wanted to be together, and they felt that they lost so many friends that day. And I was telling the kids, guys, be smart. They were taking risk, and they said, why should we? We don't have no guarantees in this life. So I can remember, and I had a pretty good rapport with the kids, and I called an assembly, and I told the kids, I said, this is not going to make any sense to you until you're parents. And hopefully you're not going to be parents for many years to come. But when you are, you don't understand what your parents went through that day when they heard for the first time there was gunfire in Columbine High School. Their hearts started beating. There was a pain and knot in their stomachs, not sure if they saw you for the last time. And I said, you need to go home and hug and love your parents. And you know what is so interesting is I see kids now, their parents, and they said, Mr. D, and they're old enough to be parents, and they said, thank you, because now I have my own little kid, and I understand what you're saying. And the things that kept me coming back is there were several girls that I told you about earlier that were in the harm's way. And I can remember a few of them walking back in my office with their kids, and they put the kids on my lap, and they said, if it wasn't for you, these kids would not be here with me. Those were the things that kept me going back year after year, because it was all about the kids in moving forward. Time to remember and a time for hope. One of the things that was so important is there was a lot of hatred built up in my heart. And I struggled, and I felt, and I was not a person that was vengeful, but there was this hatred towards the two killers because I saw the impact they had on our community. But a friend of mine said, Frank, you're a Christian. And what is one of the key tenets of being a Christian? It's about forgiveness. And sent something to me and said, basically, it was from Pope John Paul XXIII. He said, you could hate the sin, but not the sinners. And I felt if I was going to continue his principle, I could not allow that hatred to be pent up inside of me because it hurt and I could not lead. And it was that day that I forgave, not what they did, because I can't. I see Anne Marie Halter's life, who has changed. I saw the parents, who I still stay in contact, who has lost their children. But he goes on to say, do not judge and you will not be judged. Do not condemn and you will not be condemned. And forgive and you will be forgiven. And if I did not allow that to happen, I could not continue as a principal at Columbine High School. I loved my kids, and there were days. How many of you had a difficult time leaving the classroom to become an administrator? Because you're afraid you're going to lose contact with the kids. And that was my biggest fear. And then I was also afraid that if I became an administrator, I would have to change. And a dear friend of mine said, Frank, your position is changing, but you're the same person. And it doesn't matter if you were a teacher or a coach or principal or if you decide to be a superintendent, you're still the same person. Now, your job changes, but you still care about people and you'll be successful. And why? Who becomes a leader? And one of the things that was interesting, people would say, Frank, you became a leader as a result of Columbine, and I would beg to differ a little. I said I had to have certain leadership qualities in order for us to get through Columbine. I just had to use them differently, ways in which I never planned to use them. And when did it develop? You know, I worry about our kids today, and how many of you remember watching the movie Sandlot? That's how I grew up. Think of those days when you went outside and you played outside, and you didn't have coaches around. You went out and played baseball, or you went to the schoolyard and played basketball, and you rode your bike. Now, I understand there's safety concerns, but I'm afraid now that kids cannot be kids without someone supervising or things in place. I got in a little disagreement with some neighbors who has a young child who's playing competitive soccer. The kid's 8 years old, and he's paying $8,000 a summer for his kid to go play in these elite soccer tournaments. And I said, really? And I said, he can't be a kid because they're traveling every weekend. And he said, Frank, you don't understand. He said, it's going to get him a scholarship. And I said, you don't understand. Take $8,000 that you're spending every summer and put it in a college fund, and you can pay for his college plus his brother's. And they don't understand, and I worry about kids. And part of the reason I think I developed certain leadership skills or skills that I learned when I was little by playing pickup basketball or baseball games, and the kids don't have those opportunities. And I think what's important for us as leaders is we have to provide opportunities for kids to be leaders. And are we denying them those opportunities? My advice for strong leadership is visibility. And the people who raised their hands saying I was worried that I would lose contact with the kids, well, I made sure that every day I would spend at least an hour in the classroom with the kids. I would make sure every day I was down on cafeteria duty because I had opportunities. And that is the most important thing I had. I remember in high school, couldn't even tell you who my principal was. And I've had students that have come from other schools to Columbine saying, we didn't know who our principal was. We knew he had an office or she had an office. But I went out of my way. The thing that I did not like about being the principal were meetings and all the bureaucracy. And I'm looking at a superintendent. It's nothing against superintendents and bureaucracy, but my nice guy. But you're Italian, so he's good. Hey, anyway. It's important, but the other thing that's so important is I think about how I was raised by my parents, and you treat people the way you want to be treated. And there was not a time in my career that I ever had to tell a staff member or tell a parent, or excuse me, a kid, that you will do it because I'm the principal. Because I think once you do that, you lost their respect. Now, they may not always have agreed, but they knew that I cared about them. I had a dear friend of mine say, Frank, you're one of the few people that you could tell someone to kiss your butt and they'll thank you. It's how you do it. And even when I suspended and had to suspend kids, I called those kids when they were at home checking in to see how they were doing. And when they came back to school, I called them in my office. And even though they knew I could not approve of the act, they knew I still cared about them. It's about relationships. It's about caring. And you want to do something, and I didn't realize the impact it would have until I retired. Around the holiday season, we had 150 staff members, and something I said, it's no big deal, but I didn't realize what a big deal it was until I was no longer at the school, and people said, one of the things we miss about you. Around the holiday season, I would write an individual, personalized card, holiday card, a Christmas card to every faculty member. And I'm pretty anal and organized, and I knew I had 150 staff members, so right after Thanksgiving, I would write about 5 a day. And the reason I did that is if I wait until the end, all of a sudden, the last one would be, happy holidays, see you next year. But what I did is in each of those cards, I wrote personal things. And it was to the bus driver, it was to the facility manager, it was the teacher. And I would say, how's your mom? I hope her health is doing well. Or how was your son's first year of college? And it was taking the time, and I could have bought them expensive gifts, but I don't know if it would have meant the same as taking the time to find out about them. And that was so important because they knew I cared about them, not only about what they were doing in the classroom or what they were doing in that building. They knew I cared, and I took the time to find out about them. It takes time, but it paid dividends. And one of the best compliments that I received upon my retirement, and I was out of the classroom for over 20 years. And how many times have you been told you've been gone out of the classroom, you don't know what it's like to be a teacher, you're one of them? And that hurts. But you know what they told me? They said, Frank, you were not an administrator, you were an educator. You were one of us. And that's important. But you have to work at it. And I think those are the keys, advice that I would give to you as a leader. And you can see, and we could spend an entire morning talking about leadership, but you know what they are, communication, involving all, flexibility, things of that nature. It was tough after Columbine, and I'm hoping that people that are in this room never have to face what we went through. And I tell people all the time that the people at Chadron, the people at Sandy Hook, the people at Virginia Tech, we're part of a club that no one wants to be a member. And it was tough being a leader. I was named in 8 lawsuits. And that was tough. And what hurt me, not being named in the lawsuits, but knowing that there were some parents who felt I was responsible for the injuries that were caused to their kids. And I know it was a position, but it was tough. And when people were telling me I didn't care about kids, I had a lot of faults as an administrator, but the one strength that I had, and you'll see this towards the end of my presentation, is that I cared about kids and they cared about me. Felt at times you needed 2 principals, one to deal with the daily operations and one to deal with the aftermath. And it was a tough road. Every move we made was criticized, and people asked me, they said, Frank, it's been 16 years, there's been other school shootings, why are we still talking about Columbine? And I said, I wish we weren't. But I said, I really believe it's how it was reported by the media, because they brought it into our living rooms. And I remember talking to someone and they said for one entire month, CNN and the nightly news led with the story about Columbine. And you saw everything was happening. They were covering the memorial services of each kid. Our graduation, which was a little over a month after the shooting, was televised worldwide on CNN. And that's why it was the first thing, and I compare it to the Vietnam War, where they brought it into our living room. And it was the same thing with Columbine. And I'm going to talk about the media in a few minutes. You know, and it was tough. I can remember, it's kind of funny, but I can remember, it was 2002. These kids were there for all 3 years, and we were together. And they decided they were going to have some fun. They had about a month left, so they decided to have a food fight. And as a principal, you want to say you can't do that, but in the back, you're kind of saying, yes, they're being kids. Well, all of a sudden, someone from NBC or ABC National calls and said, we're going to run a nightly story at 6 o'clock about the riot that occurred at Columbine High School. I said, the riot? There was a kid who hit another kid in the head with a tater tot. It wasn't a riot. But report, 6 o'clock news, riot breaks out at Columbine High School. Please call. And I said, you've got to be kidding me. But that's because it was Columbine High School. Even, and if you've been following some of the things that are happening in Colorado, we had the Aurora Theater shooting. And right now, the person was convicted of many counts of murder, and now they're deciding the penalty phase. But I can remember it was July, 3 years ago, that I get a phone call, 4:30 in the morning, and wanted to know the comparisons between the Aurora shooting and Columbine High School, because we were 10 miles away. And everything that happens, they refer it back to Columbine High School. And so what I try to do is, again, be help where I can, but at the same time, shed a positive light. You know, the other thing that I found out, and this happens in all of our lives, how many of you know people that they're pretty emotional, pretty tough to deal with under certain normal times? There's some guarantees. Put them under stress, and those people become 10 times more difficult to deal with. Coping. You know, as I stated earlier, we told kids, be smart. But yet they said, we're going to live each day because we don't know how many days we have left. And we saw alcohol abuse. We saw drug abuse, substance abuse. We saw kids that were driving quickly and recklessly. And one of the classes that I worried the most about was the class of 1999 because they only had a month left and they were going off to school. And all of a sudden, they couldn't understand why they could not retain the information that they were reading or why they were having a meltdown during a fire drill. It was tough for the rest of us, but we had each other. They did not. And the one piece of advice I could give to you is when certain situations happen, a lot of times there's legislation out there saying you have to have problems within 3 years, if not the funds run out. And unfortunately, what we see now is post-traumatic stress disorder affects people differently. We had people that seemed to be doing fairly well 10 years out, all of a sudden they're struggling and there's no support for them. So I'm working with the group now, helping these kids that are calling me saying, Mr. D, I can't keep a job, I'm abusing drugs and alcohol. I've had parents call me of students of 2000 saying they're living in my basement. They're in trouble. Can you talk to them? Can you get them help? So that never happens. I think people really feel that you're going to wake up one day and everything's going to get back to normal. I want to talk a little bit about the media. Someone told me you never get in an argument with people who buy ink by the barrel. And what I noticed, and I have a good relationship with the media, but what I did notice during the time that the national media a lot of times would come in and report a story, and a lot of times they didn't allow the truth to stand in the way of their story. And once they were gone, they left. In the community, they would cause issues within the community and leave. The local community had to live in that community, and they were affected. And one of the things that I realized, I thought I was pretty smart, and I said, well, if I don't talk, they're not going to run a story. Well, if I didn't talk, they were going to find someone to talk to. And the other thing I found out, if they wanted to run a story, and they had a certain slant, like bullying, they really felt that the reason the two kids killed those kids was because of bullying. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. And they could have talked to 100 people that said this was a good school, bullying did not take place. Well, that's not what they were looking for. They would go find that one kid who said, yeah, I knew someone that was bullying. That's what they read. Prime example, had a situation, and they criticized me for saying that bullying never occurred. I said the bullying never occurred at Columbine. Reporter came to me and said, Frank, we want to get your input on a story that the two killers said that there was one day at school that the kids were in the cafeteria and all their classmates were there and they were taking dispensers of mustard and ketchup and they were just pouring and dumping them on their hair and it was dripping down and teachers were in there chanting, go for it, and cheering the kids. They were dropping the mustard on the two killers. And then they came over to me, supposedly, and said, Mr. D, can we go home? This is kind of embarrassing, and the mustard is staining our clothes. And I said, no, you two are losers, and you deserve everything that just happened to you. So I tell the media that that never happened. The next day, the media prints, DeAngelis denies bullying ever took place at Columbine. And that's not what happened, but that's how they turned the story. And so one of the things that I did is I used to tell the media, I said, I will grant you a story, but you're also going to come into our school and report about some of the good things that are going on. And they did. They started covering some of the positive things, because what we wanted to do is, we can't deny what happened. We can't deny what happened on April 20th. 13 people lost their lives, and they were two kids of mine that did it. We can't deny that. But that was one day. I'm here to talk about all the positive things that have happened. And remember the 13. A negativity is not an option. You know, they say that pessimists forget to laugh and optimists laugh to forget. And what we end up doing as administrators, a piece of advice, is if you think you can do it without a team, you're in trouble. And you surround yourself with good people. I think the thing I'm most proud of in my leadership is the leadership capacity. And I think a lot of times, and I know in talking to Emily, she said that we have a wide range of administrators, people that are just starting out in administration and others that are veterans. But you're going to find out, and I think early on as young administrators, you feel you have to do it all yourself. But you cannot be as effective. Surround yourself with good people, and you need to delegate. Here, delegate, but do not micromanage. Because when you micromanage, you can delegate, and if all of a sudden the people that you're giving these responsibilities to, if you're looking over their shoulder, it's going to be a matter of time. They're going to say, why do I even bother? He or she's going to redo it anyway. It's like the little kid, you tell them to go upstairs and make the bed, and then you go up and redo it. And all of a sudden the kid's saying, why do I do it? You're going to redo it anyway the way you like. It's the same thing in leadership. Develop a good team. Is there buy-in? And when someone tells you, I would run through a wall for you because I know you would do the same for me, or you have my back. Three books. I'm really feel it's important about relationships. And the one book on the end by Tommy Spaulding is Just Not Who You Know, and then Greater Than Yourself, Steve Farber. These are great books. They're easy reads. And one of the things that I did is I looked to some of the, I felt, the strongest leaders during our time. And I looked to, being a history teacher, I felt one of the strongest presidents was Abraham Lincoln, because I saw what he was able to do to keep our country together during probably the most troubling time. And I looked at Rudy Giuliani, not necessarily from the political standpoint, but I saw how he responded after 9/11 and the passion that he showed. And I mean, he went to a number of firefighters or first responders, memorial services. I got an opportunity to sit down and talk to him, and he shared a story with me how he walked a couple of the women or brides down who had lost their fathers in 9/11. It was about compassion, and I learned that from him. And then Martin Luther King Jr. and what he did. How many people saw the movie Selma? What a strong leader, and he ruled, and he got people to follow. All of our lives changed, and I'm amazed when I go out and people tell me, I remember where I was when Columbine happened. I think on that day, everybody in this country, everyone around the world realized that we had just been violated, that we were all vulnerable. I had this placard in my office, and it says, it doesn't matter. Our lives are not determined by what happens to us, but how we respond. And I had a way to go. I could have felt sorry. And I could not determine what had happened that day, but I said, how do I move forward, and how do I do it in a positive nature? It's all about attitude. Lessons learned, and I'm sure there's people saying, God, he is clueless. How did he not know those two were going to do that? The thing you need to understand at that time is we were all operating as separate entities. You had the police that had information that we're not necessarily sharing. We were not sharing information with the police. You had the judicial system not sharing. And all of a sudden, we were all dealing with it, but we were dealing with it separately. And the thing that I love when I go to these conferences is seeing educators together with SROs, together with police officials, together with mental health workers, because the bottom line is they're all of our kids, and we are responsible for them. And that is what's so important. And when we put all the information on the table, yeah, there were red flags. But we learned lessons from Columbine, that we started sharing information with the police, and the police started sharing information with us, that we had reports, and we realized that there are kids in your schools that are crying out for help. And are we providing the help for them? You know, different people are in different places. If you ever get a chance to get Rachel's challenge to come to your school, it's Rachel Scott was the first young lady that was killed at Columbine. Her dad and her brother end up going and speaking about creating a welcoming environment. This is the wall, and right here, that's Craig Scott. That was Rachel's brother. He had an argument with Rachel that morning, and she was the first one killed, but was even as devastating as he lost his sister, but he was also under a table with three of the kids who lost their life, and he survived. And he struggled, and we were really worried about where he was headed. And he ended up now going out and speaking on behalf of Rachel. Oops. The wall. I call it the wall of 99. And people said, how can you walk in your office each day and look at that? And I said, there's a reason I do that. It keeps me coming back in this building for them. That even though I know they're not with us physically, they're with us spiritually. And there were certain things that happened. Right here is Mr. Velasquez's, Kyle Velasquez's hat. And what I did is when each of the kids that were killed on that day were supposed to graduate, I would call their families in and I would present them with the cap and gown and a diploma. On this, and it was very emotional for everyone involved. And on that day, Kyle's parents, Al and Phyllis Velasquez, walk in. And I give them a diploma, and we're crying. And Mr. Velasquez says, you know, we're crying because we lost him. But by the end, we need to smile because we had him. And he took the hat off his head, and he said, this is Kyle's hat, and I know he would want you to have it. Because these kids will take care of you just like you tried to take care of them. That's what allowed me to walk back in Columbine each and every day. The cost... I was in 6 car accidents in the month of April. I was not texting. My wife will not ride with me in the month of April. She said, give me money for light rail, public transportation, but I will not get in the car. And it's because I know when I need to go in for maintenance. And it could be a day just like it was that day, 70 degrees. I could hear a certain song and my mind wanders. I know by the dreams that I'm having. But now I'm not saying, God, what is going on with me? I know that I need to go on and get help. Excuse me. I've had several bouts where I went into the hospital thinking I was having a heart attack and it was anxiety related. I'm sorry. Boy, that must have been a heck of a cough. Another piece of advice. You know, I took care of myself. But one of the things that happened is after I left each day at Columbine, and it was tough days, 12 and 13 hours, I'd go home and the last thing I wanted to do is share my daily experiences with my wife because I didn't want to relive it. I needed to rejuvenate for those 2 or 3 hours. And where I made a mistake is I got myself help, but they should have been there with me finding out why I was acting the way I was acting. I could not look at people eye to eye because I felt so much guilt. When we would go out with my family or we'd socialize, I would go off by myself because I did not want to talk to anyone. Everybody said, we're losing him. I can remember my daughter, Haley, and I'm still working on this. She was a sophomore in high school, and she said, my daddy didn't get killed that day, but I lost my daddy. She's 34 years old, and I'm still looking at repairing that relationship because I took care of everyone else's kids. And I put mine on the back burner, and it's something I have to live with the rest of my life. Don't allow that to happen because we're in jobs that we're taking care of everyone else, but don't forget your family because they will be there with you through thick and thin. People ask, new normal, when does it get back? You're not going to wake up some morning and it's going to be back to normal. We had to define what normal is. And some do's and don'ts, and we can talk about this later, but safe to tell, if you're interested in this, it's a great program. It's an anonymous tip line, standard response protocol. I know there's some people that are going to present, and I'm looking forward to hearing. I know it's going to be great. And people ask, what do you think caused it? And I always said these two killers did not come out of their mother's womb hating. What happened from the time they were born? And I saw these kids in their little soccer uniform or Boy Scout uniforms. What happened from the time They were attending scout meetings to the time they walked in Columbine High School and opened up fire. And so many times, and someone was asking me this morning, do we need metal detectors? Do we need cameras? People can see those, and they're saying, yeah, we're taking safety precautions, just like it for Sandy Hook, where they had lockdown. What they didn't anticipate was a shooter shooting through the glass to get in the building. Don't underestimate the power of programs to help these kids that are crying out for help, and they want to cut counseling and mental health. Don't allow it to happen. Fight for the rights of these kids. Retirement. People said, why? And it was interesting. I made a promise the first few years, 3 years. But then I remember what Father Ken said. You need to rebuild that community. So I decided to stay until every kid who was in an elementary school had graduated because I wanted to hand a diploma. That was preschool kids would graduate in 2012. So I had a parent come up and say, you can't leave. My kid was in the first year of a two-year preschool program. So I stayed. And then I stayed one more year. And a parent comes up, and I had her four kids, and she hugged me and said, thank you, thank you, thank you for being here. It was a wonderful experience. And she had a kid in a stroller, and I said, oh, that is so neat. You got your grandchild. She said, no, that's my child. Can you be here until 2025? And I said, no, we're done. Talked a little bit about Gerda Wiseman Klein, and I think the message she sent to us is, she was a Holocaust survivor, but we were able to turn pain into healing, ignorance into enlightenment, and hatred into love. And these are some things. We learned how to give generously and receive graciously. And if you're interested in a program to develop generous leaders, talk to me, and I'm going to be here all day today. I want to end with a couple of things. As administrators, know all of your kids. I was naive because I went and found the kids who were going to tell me what I wanted to hear. And I found the kids who said, yes, we are Columbine. Yes, we love this school. What I underestimated were those kids that were at the smoking pit, those kids that were at the skate park, those kids that were at the court or food court and not in their classes. And I went and found them and I said, what is it going to take for you to be a part of Columbine? And they were brutally honest and they told me what I needed to hear. I didn't necessarily want to hear it, but they told me we became a better school and we changed things. And I told teachers, I don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And think about it. When you hire people, are they energy takers or are they energy givers? I want the energy givers because those are the ones that are going to make a difference. We had to change the culture. We had to believe. And I want to show you how we can do that. This was an assembly, and I told the kids that if they won a state championship, I would allow them to throw me up in the air. I also realized they could drop me, but they did not. This is something that made a difference, and I'm going to end on this with a video. I had a chain in there on my case, and I gave each kid a carabiner. And they walked into an assembly. There were 1,700 kids, including parents, kids, and staff members. And I told them that each of them represented this link. And each of you are an individual, and that's what makes Columbine so special. But I said, when you hook these links together, now you become the class of 2015. You're stronger. You're individuals, but you're strong as a class. But I said, what really makes Columbine strong is when you take all 1,700 and we come together as one. So I put on this song, We Are Family. And I said, by the conclusion of this song, we are going to be one. Played the song, all of a sudden parents are up, kids are up, all of a sudden the song stops and around our gymnasium everyone's linked together and holding up this chain. And so I went on to say that I said, there's going to be days that you may have failed a test, you're fighting with your boyfriend, girlfriend, parent, but when you're feeling that, I want you to walk in the hallway and realize that you are connected to someone, that you are part of Columbine, you are part of this family, and I love you guys. Don't ever forget that. And what I would do is when they would graduate, I would give them their link saying, even though you're graduating, you're still part of our Columbine family. And you will always be part of Columbine. And I see kids now that are in their 20s or I go to their weddings and they pull out this key ring of We Are Columbine. And here's what I want to end with. There was a young man. Here's a young man who had been in 8 or 9 foster homes, 8 different high schools. It's my last assembly. And I'm not sure, what are you going to say to people after you've been there for 35 years? And I wanted to have a very special assembly, and it wasn't, I used to do crazy things. I came in as Barry Manilow one time Rocky Balboa. Well, my last assembly, I wanted to make it special, but I wasn't sure what I was going to say. On the day that I was getting ready for the assembly, this young man, the kid who had just came into Columbine a year prior, put a letter into my mailbox. And I looked up and I said, thank you, because now I knew how I was going to end my school year with this assembly. Here's my last assembly. You know, that one young man said, you were more of a father to me than my own dad. And my advice to each and every one of you is every day you walk in your school, you don't know whose life you could be impacting. And this was a kid who came up every day and put his arm around me. Mr. D, how you doing? You have a great day. Calvin, you have a great day. And I was doing all right my last day until he said that. And I realized I fulfilled my mission after I made that promise 15 years ago to create an environment and rebuild us. And that's what it's all about, caring about kids. Leave a legacy, make a difference. And that's what you're doing by being here during your summer vacation to do this. You know, Martin Luther King Jr. had a dream. What's your dream when you return back to school this year? What are you going to do to make a difference in a kid's life? What do you want your school to look like 5 years from now, 10 years from now? I told you I made a promise to those 13 on that day, but this is my little granddaughter, Mia Isabella. She's going to be 2 years old, and each time I see her and I hold her and I make a promise, a mental note saying, I never want you, never, to have to experience what those poor little kids had to experience. It's Sandy Hook. And I'm going to do everything in my power if I got to travel around the country and the world to spread the word. A time to remember and a time to hope. She's my special angel, and I'm just so honored to be here, and thank you for all that you have done. Thank you.